Ryan Reynolds here from Mint Mobile. With the price of just about everything going up during inflation, we thought we'd bring our prices down. So to help us, we brought in a reverse auctioneer, which is apparently a thing.
Mint Mobile Unlimited Premium Wireless. How to get 30, 30, how to get 30, how to get 20, 20, 20, how to get 20, 20, how to get 15, 15, 15, 15, just $15 a month? Sold!
Give it a try at mintmobile.com/switch.
$45 up front payment equivalent to $15 per month. New customers on first 3 month plan only. Taxes and fees extra. Speeds slower above 40 gigabytes in detail.
This episode is brought to you by Allstate. Some people just know they could save hundreds on car insurance by checking Allstate first. Like, you know to check you have the tickets in your wallet first before you drive 2 hours to the big game. Seriously, you had one job. Now the closest you'll get to the 50-yard line is parking lot D. Yeah, checking first is smart. So check Allstate first for a quote that could save you hundreds. You're in good hands with Allstate. Savings vary. Terms apply. Allstate Fire and Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Northbrook, Illinois.
Deciding which credit card or loan is right for you is like trying to choose where you want to eat for dinner. Except when you finally get to the restaurant, the menu is riddled with jargon that no average foodie could understand. So at Credit Karma, we keep things simple. We show you personalized recommendations that align with your money goals and help you turn the confusing fine print into terms you can actually understand. And as a cherry on top, we provide a detailed overview for a new card or loan before you apply. That way, we can help you make decisions faster and with more confidence. Download Intuit Credit Karma today to get started.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is showtime. Please welcome the team of the Fulhamish podcast.
It's the Fulhamish podcast, your independent voice of Fulham FC. My name's Sammy James and welcome to the show. Today it is the Thursday Club. We're looking ahead to our trip to Goodison Park on Saturday. Probably the final trip to Goodison unless we get them in the FA Cup. So let's enjoy it and hopefully end our time at a ground that we didn't used to do very well at on a bit of a high. I'm joined on the Thursday Club today by Elizabeth Barnard. Hello.
Hi, Sammy. How are you?
Good, thank you. You said earlier it's your debut on the Thursday Club, which I am kind of shocked by, but here we are.
Yeah, been on Fulhamish for a couple of years, but first time on the Thursday Club. Ever since I was a little girl, I dreamed of this moment. So it's an honour to be sat on these sofas.
Oh, it's an honour to have you, Liz. Jack is in Porto this week, so I believe he's been in Galicia, as they say. You can't say the C, you've got to say Galicia. And he's now on his way to Portugal. So he's having a lovely week in the Iberian Peninsula.
Good for him. We're in Hammersmith. So slightly, almost as glamorous, I'd say.
Almost as glamorous. But we get the joy of having the final word on Saturday's game against Villa. The one thing about doing the live show, as much as I love it, is that that podcast is quite raw, reactionary. None of us have really had time to look at the highlights or anything like that. Obviously, it's really fun doing it in front of an audience. Thank you to everyone that came on Saturday. It was a wonderful evening, wasn't it, Liz?
So fun. I met so many wonderful people afterwards as well. Just so much fun. Stayed way too late.
I've got to give a shout out to somebody that I met and they were begging me, please mention her on the podcast. And I promised them that I would. But it's so worthy of mentioning anyway, even if I hadn't been strong-armed into doing it at the pub. Her name is Bethany.
Mm. Yeah.
And if this is a wind-up, then I'm sorry, but I don't think it was. Bethany has travelled to every home game this season and is planning on doing... she's got a season ticket at Craven Cottage. She's planning on going to every Fulham home game. She lives in Washington, D.C. And she flies over Friday night, lands at London on a Saturday morning, stays one night, goes back Sunday, and is back at her desk for Monday 9 a.m. in Washington, D.C. I mean, that's the first I've heard of that.
That level of commitment is unbelievable. Like, I think I have to commute like an hour, couple of hours. I live out of London to Craven Cottage.
Oxford.
And I feel Oxford, that's where I live. And I feel like I'm really putting in those hard yards. Washington, D.C., Bethany. That's incredible.
And she was just so chilled about it as well, as if literally she was maybe doing a couple of hours on the train. No, like she was on the United Airlines flight on a Friday evening out of Washington, D.C. airport. And I couldn't believe my ears. And so, yeah, shout out to Bethany.
Shout out to Bethany. That's incredible. I hope to see you at a game soon.
Yeah. And she came to the Fulhamish live show, which is, you know, even more commitment. You could be doing so many cool things in Washington, and yet you're at the Half Moon Putney watching Fulhamish live.
I think that's almost as cool, though.
Almost. Yeah, final word on Villa. As I mentioned, we're obviously a bit reactionary on Saturday. We don't have a lot of time to think about it. Now the dust has settled, are you a bit more... I mean, you were fairly relaxed over the result anyway on Saturday, but obviously there was quite a lot of anger and frustration at certain players, and some of it understandably.
Yeah, I mean, obviously Pereira was the big one. Like, we spoke a lot about him on Saturday, to the point that we had to put a ban on Pereira-related questions halfway through. I think we'll come on to it, but I really think we can chalk it up as one of those now. Having taken some time to, you know, have a break from it, a few days. One thing, though, that I don't think I really realised at the time, but having watched back, I would say maybe too many times, that burnt Leno assist. If you haven't watched it back, like, go watch it, you know, three or four times. It's incredible.
He proper thumps it, doesn't he?
It's unbelievable.
I think if he hits it any harder, he's in danger of lobbing Martinez and going in the goal. It's a one hell of a kick from him.
Yeah, this is maybe a bit of a niche reference, but it's a Fulhamish podcast, so niche references about Fulham galore. I remember there was like a video that he did about the Premier League did about Fulham's goal celebrations and like all the big players' goal celebrations. And he's interviewed in it and he's like, well, I'm still waiting for my first professional goal. They're like, okay, what would your celebration be? And he goes crazy. Like, he takes his shirt off. He's like, this is how I celebrate. Imagine if we'd seen that on Saturday. And then imagine if we'd still lost 3-1.
Well, we did complete a hat-trick of sorts on Saturday. So I wanted to give a message out. Shout out to Jew Josephus on Twitter, who tweeted this, said, reliably informed that last Saturday, Fulham made Premier League history as the first team to suffer a missed penalty, an own goal and a red card in one game. And we put it on the Fulhamish Instagram, and shout out to Chris Inman 11 and said, this needs a name. We shall call it the Fulhamish hat trick.
Which so, is a so start.
Well, you got a lot of love for that comment. It is the Fulhamish. I cannot believe that's never happened in a Premier League game before. It didn't feel that remarkable on Saturday, but actually, yeah, how often do you see that? Well, clearly never.
I guess it felt like those incidents were all a bit spread out. Not the own goal and the red card, maybe, but they weren't all in the same half. That's amazing. That kind of stat makes me proud to be Fulham. It's just like in, well, 20s maybe a stretch, or maybe 3 years, there will be a pub quiz saying which club is the only club to have done this. And it'll be us. And that's beautiful.
Yeah. It's one that might come up again, you know, when it's on this day. It might be one of those that we, even though it was a defeat, we remember on this day when Fulham somehow managed to achieve this. So yeah. And a goalkeeper assist. Like, my mum and my wife came to the game on Saturday and they tried to put a positive spin on the game afterwards because they were just trying to be cheerful. And my mum was like, well, it was a very entertaining game, wasn't it? And for a time I was like, oh, shut up. Just that we've lost. Just accept the L and like stop trying to like make a positive spin out of it. But actually, she's right. It was like, it was a quite remarkable game. Obviously, it didn't go our way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very, very entertaining. just comical. The kind of thing that makes me happy to support this team in some ways, even though the result was disappointing. But also, like three, I would say, very unlucky incidents. Like, usually Andreas Pereira would score a penalty. Usually for me, that's not a red card. And, you know, usually Diop's not in that place to put it into the goal. So I don't know if we can necessarily draw too many conclusions about Fulham as a team in general from those three incidents.
Well, also, there was a knock-on effect. Like, I think one thing led to another. And I think one... You forget, like, how much that momentum swung on Saturday when Pereira missed that penalty.
Yeah.
Like, I think until that penalty, it's a really balanced game. Mm. I think either side can go on and win it. Villa really put their foot down after that missed penalty, and I think you can see why, right? Football was a lot about momentum, and it really swung their way after that. I'm still in two minds about this. There's been a lot of chatter online about how Raul should have taken the penalty. I can't just but help think there's a bit of revisionism on this. I know he scored the last one, but at the same time, if Marco Silva, and there seemed to be anger afterwards at Andreas for taking it off Raul. I mean, I think if anyone's to blame here, if indeed there needs to be any blame, it's Marco Silva, right? He has specifically said he made a big old deal after the Forest game of saying Andreas should have taken it, kind of it's lucky it went in. I mean, the team were just following orders. And Marco's obviously watched them all take penalties in training and has decided that that's the player. So as much as none of us want to blame Marco, he's the only one at fault here for that decision. But I also think once in a blue moon, players miss penalties.
Yeah, I agree. And yeah, 100% agree. If it's anyone's fault, it's Marco Silva's. But equally, Andreas Pereira has been an excellent penalty taker for us before. He scored that 1v City and he scored, I think, all the other ones he's taken for us over various shootouts and things. So even though Raul took the one at Forest and scored it, it doesn't mean that necessarily he would have scored this one. He was the right person. Marco was the one who made the decision. He was the one that wants Andreas to take it. It wasn't like Andreas was there stealing the ball off Raul for his game. Like, you know, Cameron Mitrovic situation back in the day.
Well, if anything, Raul did that in the last game.
Yeah, I mean, that I know was controversial because Andreas had gone down injured, so maybe he wasn't actually allowed to take it.
Yeah, anyway, it was hard to know.
Yeah. But this one, definitely. If Marco says it should be Andreas, it should be Andreas.
I guess there's now a case to be answered, right? Whether they'll have looked at it and thought, maybe. I guess what makes the miss worse, and this is similar into the Ademola Lookman argument as well, I hate those run-ups. Weird little jazzy knees. I mean, I don't know if you've seen the reverse angle of, I'm not sure which Villa player it was, but he was imitating Andreas as he took the penalty, which was quite funny.
I haven't seen it. I fear it might make my blood boil.
It normally would make my blood boil, but in hindsight, it was just relatively funny. But it was a poor penalty. And actually, I don't know if you watched Arsenal Shakhtar last night in the Champions League, but Leandro Trossard's missed penalty. He does the same. He does that weird little quick knees thing and didn't take a very good penalty either. I'm not sure. There's obviously some sort of science behind it, but I'm not 100% sure I buy it.
I have a not very interesting middle ground take about this. Great for a podcast. which is that Panenkas are adjacent penalties that aren't power into a corner. They are trying to deceive the goalkeeper. That breed of penalty is actually really successful and usually comes off, but it looks so dense if it doesn't. It looks really stupid. And I think the same can be said for penalties that go straight down the middle. They're really effective, but you look really stupid if they don't go in. And it was just a classic case of that. I mean, the Lookman penalty, I actually don't even want to have that brought back into my brain. That was like truly, truly awful. And it was a bad penalty. But I still think 50% of the time that goes in, which isn't high enough, but it's still, you know, something.
And we got a lot of flack on the quick take that Yasmin and I did. Where, I mean, I actually was much stronger than Yaz by saying that I don't think it was a red card for Joachim Andersen. I still don't. I'm still actually sticking to my gun on that I think it's soft as hell. And that, okay, you know, the argument of like, if it was the other way around, would you want a red card? Of course I would. Like, I accept that there's always an element of bias. But I still think it was mostly shoulder to shoulder. I still kind of think that, I think if you're a referee, you have to be 100% sure that it absolutely denied a goal scoring opportunity. I don't know. What's your thoughts on this?
Yeah. As soon as he blew that whistle, I died dead. I was like, as soon as he blew up on it, you knew it was going to be a red. But I agree. I don't think it was, I don't think it was a foul that brought Watkins down. That meant that he didn't have that clear-cut goal-scoring opportunity. And therefore, I don't think it was a red card.
No.
I stand by that.
I think Dan was right, though, on the podcast afterwards, where he said it was a failure by Fulham to allow that situation
to
even develop. But
And I don't think it's like a catastrophic error enough that it should have been overturned.
No.
I mean, VAR is kind of a shambles at the moment anyway, but it wasn't clear and obvious.
Yeah. I'm kind of more on board with VAR than I've ever been before. And I'm still not massively on board, but I do respect this kind of like, there's a bit more transparency in that mostly what you see the referee make.
Yeah.
They're not going to overturn it unless there's an absolutely gigantic error. And you just knew at the time there was they could go to VAR, but they were never seriously going to overlook that unless they somehow found that actually Anderson had won the ball or something, which I think we all could quite clearly see there was a coming together of both of them. And you either were going to judge it one way or the other, weren't you? It was going to be Watkins fouling Anderson somehow or Anderson fouling Watkins. There was always a decision that had to be made there. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. I think it's soft, but c'est la vie, we move on. It was a difficult game against Villa. And I think there's maybe been a bit of that forgotten at the time, maybe because it's Aston Villa.
Yep.
Like with all due respect to Aston Villa, I think I'm still coming to terms with the fact that they are a very good club. I think I still remember Aston Villa being the team that we played in the Championship 5 years ago. Like, they've won 3 from 3 in the Champions League.
Yeah.
You know, we've got 2 defeats in a row, but it's 2 very good teams. Mm-hmm. Now the fixtures are turning and looking quite kind. Everton, Brentford, Palace, Wolves.
12 points. anyone who finds this video who's a fan of one of those teams, I am joking.
But I mean, this is the point in the season now where Fulham, you know, we're already in a pretty good position. We are 10th. It changed after Forest the other night. We are around 10th, maybe 11th. I'm now checking. We are 10th.
We are 10th. Top half.
So we are in the top half. This is the point of the season for me where Fulham need to kick on and get some wins, because I think we've got to make hay while the sun shines, because all four of those teams are very beatable. I think possibly the toughest task out of all of them is the one coming up.
Yeah, it's unfortunate that we're playing Everton at this moment. I feel like, well, we know if we'd played them earlier in the season, it would have been easy. And we were lucky we played them first game of last season and won and were pretty terrible, but still won because they were worse. And they're 4 unbeaten now. Maybe going to make it 5 against us. I don't know. I don't know. I think it's difficult because we're missing Anderson. That will be difficult. But equally, I still think we are a better team than them on paper. And I know football matches aren't played on paper, but there's no reason why we shouldn't be able to go to Goodison Park and win.
100%. I think like you can't look at that Everton team, look at our team. But I think obviously we have got 2 big absentees. Sasa Lukic still missing in the middle.
That's really big.
And we know that we're going to be missing Joachim Andersen. Unless something dramatic happens with the appeal between now and Saturday, I don't personally see it. Apparently Marco and his team were thinking about appealing. I'm not 100% sure whether we did or not, but
it's not going to get overturned in my eyes.
It's not going to get overturned. But you look at this Everton squad, and there is obviously some quality in there. I think Ndiaye on the left wing has been an exceptional signing for them. Dominic Calvert-Lewin on his day at Goodison Park can still be a striker to be feared. I've always quite liked Jack Harrison, kind of always thought he was the type of player that might play for us. And actually Dwight McNeil has probably been their best player this season. So going forward, they've got threats, but I still think that a team that has, that is without Branthwaite at the back, that's still relying on 45-year-old Ashley Young at right back.
Yeah.
And put Jordan Pickford, who's got an error or two in him, is still definitely there to be got at. But it's always tough to go to Goodison, apart from in the last 3 years.
Yeah, it's a difficult one. It feels like, do you remember when Burnley were in the Premier League, those good old days? And everyone was like, oh, Turf Moor, like tough place to go. But really it wasn't, actually.
Yeah.
Like, it was quite easy to go to Turf Moor. Not for us, obviously. We never win there, but for most teams.
Yeah.
And that feels a bit like the way that people talk about Goodison Park. Like, if you get the first goal and the crowd start to lose it a little bit, especially considering the start they had to the season, throwing away those 2 goals leads, 2 games in a row, like, the crowd is not, despite their recent turnaround in form, it's not a happy place.
Yeah.
It's not a place that feels like it's performing well. Yeah, I feel like we could definitely get something.
And they've had a good run of fixtures. Like, let's be fair here. Yeah, yes, you're right. They are 4 unbeaten, but They played Leicester away, who actually improving, but still, you know, a promoted team. They played Palace at home, who are terrible. One of the worst teams in the division so far. Newcastle at home, and Newcastle are on pretty shoddy form. Mm-hmm. And they then beat Ipswich Town away. A good result, don't get me wrong, but again, winless. So I don't think that you can necessarily hang your hat on those four games and be like, Everton have made it. Everton have completely fixed this. I think you're right. It is that Goodison Park atmosphere, and Fulham have managed to play that to our advantage in recent years, where the slightest thing goes wrong and they do turn. They also, the slightest thing goes right and you're in a bit of a nightmare in terms of it can be a huge benefit to them when they have got their tails up. Like, everything feels like it's going against you and the Gladys Street feels like it's sucking the ball in. But at the same time, I believe that in Fulham's ability, I guess the key thing from a Fulham perspective is, how do we solve this midfield problem?
Great question. Oh, well, away from home and a difficult place to go, in theory. I don't think Berg was that impressive on Saturday, but I don't know how we don't play him.
I mean, you can put Harrison Reed in there.
So who's your midfield three then?
I was thinking about this earlier. I think I think actually my midfield three is Sander Berger, Harrison Reed, and I hate to say it, Andreas.
Obviously Andreas plays.
My midfield three, if I was in charge, I think I would do Reed, Berger and Smith Rowe, because I'd like to have some fun. What I think Marco, but I'm trying to put myself 50% in what I think Marco will do, and I just do not think that Marco ever drops Andreas Pereira. It gives you more solidity.
I feel like having Andreas in the 10 on Saturday will mean that we have a little bit of a better work rate, and I think that's what we need away from home. I think I'd put him in. I mean, it's kind of a moot discussion because we know Marco well.
I think the thing with Smith Rowe for me, I am starting to agree that Smith Rowe and Pereira in the same team isn't working amazingly, and that Lukic was maybe holding that glue together a couple of times where it has worked. You know, that Smith Rowe and Pereira worked fine against Newcastle. Smith Rowe and Pereira worked fine against West Ham for most of the game and worked well against Forest. Mm-hmm. Although Smith Rowe was pretty anonymous against Forest. But, and part of me is very hesitant whether we should judge that partnership on a game against Man City, where obviously they didn't get the chance to play together, but we changed it because it was Manchester City, and actually a very, 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 very good Aston Villa. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe we should have a bit more confidence and say, look, let's try the Smith Rowe and Pereira thing one more time. It's Everton. It's a team that we're going to have much more control of the ball than again in the last two games, and see if it works.
So you're saying Berger, Smith Rowe, Pereira?
I'm toying between it. I don't really know exactly what the answer is. I mean, for all of Pereira's ills on Saturday, I thought Berger was the worst player on the pitch.
Yeah.
And Smith Rowe, I think Pereira out of the three of them was the least worst. But the penalty instantly docks you a couple of points because it was so bad.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think I would love to see Harrison Reed play. I'm a big Harrison Reed fan. He's been great at Goodison before. I know that that doesn't make much difference, but I would really like to see him play. So I'd like to have him in there. I think I don't see any way we can't not play Berger. I think we need a bit more solidity. And I don't think, I agree, he wasn't good, but I still think there's no way we can't play him. And then I think Pereira and Rasmus throw. Because the chance of us getting another penalty low, and the chance of us getting another penalty and Andreas Pereira taking it and taking it like that, I would say very low.
Yeah.
So.
And also the thing with Smith Rowe, and he struggled particularly on Saturday, I think Smith Rowe needs a bit of time and space. And Villa didn't give that to him. Yeah. Villa hassled and harried him. And maybe if he comes off the bench with even a good, you know, good half an hour to go, and hopefully by then everyone's a bit more tired. And if you've got a fresh Smith Rowe coming in, picking up the ball from deep, dictating play, I think Smith Rowe will have a better time of it. I'm sure he doesn't want to be seen as an impact sub.
Yeah.
I'm sure that's not what he joined lowly Fulham for.
He definitely didn't.
But at the same time, like, we obviously this was always the problem of having so many players and so mm-hmm. you know, so much depth. Even without Lukic, it's we're trying to fit square peg in round hole, really, because we've just got too many options and too many good options. It's a nice problem to have, but people have to be disappointed. Someone's going to have to drop out and accept their place on the bench.
Yeah, I think if Lukic is fit, the team is much easier to pick, but unfortunately we don't have that luxury. I was at the live show just before we went on stage. I was chatting with George and he was saying, you know, this is the first game where I've really felt like, boy, have we missed Polinia. I was like, yeah, but really Lukic has been picking up so much of that from Polinia. He was one yellow card away from a ban before Manchester City. So really, like, you know, emulating our fallen soldier.
That's going to be a bit rough, isn't it? The day we get Lukic back, if he gets a bloody yellow card and then we miss him again.
But then we know that it's only one game and he's fine. And maybe it'll fall really kindly when we miss him. I don't know. Hopefully.
And then, I mean, at centre-back, it's Diop, right? It's going to be easy Diop in there. And can you foresee any other changes? I'm not sure, really.
No, I don't think so. I think we go with the same lineup, apart from Diop. Cuenca, I just thought, was quite poor in the cup.
Yeah, I don't think he's 100% fit either. I noticed that he was a doubt for Aston Villa. So, I think it's easy Diop. The only one, then, it came up on Saturday, and I think maybe asked Jackie this, and she wasn't so sure. But I didn't hate the Iwobi in the eight suggestion. I didn't hate it. But the only thing is, for me, is I look at Sander Berger and I watched him play and I do just think he's not a six. I think he is an eight. And so really, like, I don't know if Iwobi dropping in, and Iwobi's not going to play six. Iwobi's going to play eight if he's going to play anywhere. I think if you bring in Harrison Reed, you take that pressure off Sander Berger. You take that pressure off Sander Berger to try and do this, you know, role that Lukic has been doing brilliantly this season, where it's kind of a mixture between the both. You just go for something a bit more basic in there. It'll hopefully stifle any attacking threat that Everton have. And you look at someone like Dwight McNeil, you need to stop him. And you need that whole front line can all grab a goal or two. If you can hold that dead, hold resilient. And we did that last time at Everton, didn't we? We hold firm, we got lucky. Bert Leno pulled off some great saves. And then with the quality we got up front, Adama Traore against Ashley Young.
I can't wait to see it.
Like, that's got to be the game plan, right? It feels perfect against that Everton defence that are all pretty slow and cumbersome. And you can isolate Adama against any of them.
And actually, Raul is just playing exceptionally well at the moment as well.
Yeah.
So, like, easy man of the match for Saturday. and easily been man of the match so many times. Just excellent. So, yeah, as long as we can keep them out, I think we've got a good chance of going there and getting something.
All right, let's do some emails before we finish. So I'm going to go first to Mitchell. Says, hey lads, long time listener, second time emailer from New Zealand. I love when we hear listeners from Australia, New Zealand. Just feels cool because it's the other side of the world.
100%.
I don't think we've ever got one from Fiji or like Vanuatu yet. But if you do live in Fiji, Vanuatu, or any of the Pacific Islands, please get in touch. Because
if you're in New Zealand, what time are you waking up for the games? Is it middle of the night stuff?
I think so. I mean, it's basically either 11 or 12 hours. So yeah, that's real commitment. In fact, I'm sure Mitchell will quite appreciate 5:30 kickoff. Because that might mean like just an early Saturday, you know, a six-ish.
Yeah, or a lunchtime kickoff, stay up late.
Yeah, that's probably quite good as well.
Yeah.
Basically, all the times that we don't like are better, really good for New Zealand. Like the Man United 7 p.m, everyone's moaning about that, 7 p.m on a Sunday. But actually for Mitchell,
He's getting up, having his breakfast.
7 a.m. on Monday morning, just goes to work. I bet Mitchell loves that kickoff time.
So, yeah, let us know.
Yeah, anyway.
Be a third time emailer.
Mitchell says, you're going to need to hear me out on this, but I honestly think we are a better team without Smith Rowe. If you think back to his games this season, aside from the 2 goals and 1 assist, there aren't any other memorable moments from his game. Obviously, it's great to have a player who can pop up with a goal out of nowhere, but Smith Rowe doesn't feel like that player. If you compare him to Nelson, you can see the vast difference in level. What do you guys think about him? I know he's come back from injury, but it's been 2 months now, and that performance against Villa isn't what you'd expect for your record signing.
I agree that performance against Villa is not what you'd expect for your record signing. And I also agree that I've been much more excited by Nelson when we've seen him on the pitch. But I do think with Nelson, there is a thing, I'm not sure how you feel about this, where he's our player for now, and that's great. And I love playing him, and I want to play our best team. But I'm very aware that we're giving him back to Arsenal next summer, and I don't want to develop him and make him a real key centre point in this team for that reason.
Yeah.
I want his role to be an impact sub if at all possible. But Mitchell has said, aside from, you know, these goal involvements, and he has been good in quite a few of the games, Smith Rowe. Like, maybe there's a bit of recency bias because he was poor against Forest and poor against Villa, but I do think he's been impressive.
I think maybe it was a little bit naive from all of us to expect Smith Rowe to come in and suddenly be the answer straight away.
Yeah.
From a player that had been out for so long. Like, there is a player that got 10 and 10 in that kind of 2021 season.
Mm-hmm.
There is obvious, you have to be pretty good to do that in the Premier League, whether you're playing for Arsenal, whether you're playing for anyone. And the Arsenal weren't particularly great that season either. And he was such an instrumental player. There is obviously something there. I see Smith Rowe as a bit of a long-term option, where I wouldn't be surprised this season if he's not bit part, but also not necessarily absolute first name on the team sheet. He's in and out of the team. He has moments. But if we can get Smith Rowe either firing really on all cylinders by the end of the season, or at the very worst for the start of next, then I think we have a hell of a player on our hands. I think it's going to just take a little bit of time for him to find his feet. And clearly, I think it's maybe a fair but a bit of a harsh term to say he's been a bit of a flat track bully, in that he's performed well in the games against like worst teams, and then he came up against a very good team in Aston Villa on Saturday and found it tough. But we've got 4 nice games now. Like, I think this is the point where, like, he can hopefully start to shine in this team. I don't think it's all over, but I do get that from a record side. I think when you make a record signing, you just want them to absolutely start flying, don't you?
Yeah, for that amount of money. And we've seen it before, like a couple of seasons ago, Polina came in and was just exceptional instantly. And that feeling of, oh my God, what have we... Like, we signed the best player in the world. It's really special. I agree with you. I think Smith Rowe will develop and become who we want him to be.
This is actually a question that I'm definitely saving for next week, but I want to read it out to you just because funny. Brian Chapman says, hi team, a couple of weeks ago Jack read out my email about Andreas Pereira. After the performance on Saturday against Villa, all I can say is, Jack, what would it take? I know you were in Spain, but hopefully you've watched the match back and may now have a tiny little chunk of doubt in your mind. Brian then said, I was at the live show but didn't ask a question about AP, as he was getting enough grief from the rest of the audience, and Maurice's question was funnier than mine. So we'll bank that one for next week, shall we? And get Jack's take on Andreas Pereira.
Yeah, see what Jack's going to say. I mean, I get it. I'm also quite soft on Pereira, but yeah.
I'm soft on Pereira as well. There was a couple of moments on Saturday which were utterly frustrating. His passing was off. There was that weird moment in the second half where it looked like he was about to have a shot. He got completely caught in two minds. I think he lost the Hammersmith end at that point.
Yeah.
I also agreed massively. I think it was Loz who said this on Saturday's podcast. I hated the sarcastic applause. Yeah. I get it that people are frustrated. Mm-hmm. I just don't think it helps. Unless you are purposefully, and not many players ever do this, trying to hurt the team, I don't know in what way it can ever help.
Yeah, I think the only reason why you should ever boo your own player is A, if they're like an actual terrible person, or B, if they are just showing a total lack of effort. And one thing you can never criticise Andreas for is his work rate. I found it really disappointing on Saturday as well.
I must admit, I do think there may have been some confusion about, for me, what the booing was. I think that there was an isolated pocket of people cheering as his number came up. And I then think that the booing from the rest of the Hammersmith end was actually people trying to show their disapproval for the fans that clearly were cheering him off. I honestly believe that you do not get a full Hammersmith end booing a player. Because that was kind of what was in my mind as well, as I was just, I wanted to make it clear that that isn't something that's helping the team in any way.
Yeah. I mean, I clapped him off, not because I thought, oh, he deserved it based on this performance, but I always would. So maybe that like contributes to noise. And I also think boos are often a lot, or carry a lot more than cheers. But there was still a lot of people around me standing up, like waving him off.
Yeah.
Stuff that I just don't think is necessarily helpful. I mean, it's up to you how you support.
It is up to you. I just couldn't get my head around that. We're 10th.
Yeah.
We're 10th in the division. We're playing brilliant football this season. You know, we lost on Saturday, fair enough, and we lost against City, and, you know, we got to arrest this. If it becomes 3, 4, 5 defeats in a row, then it is concerning. But, like, I don't know, it smacks of something that you could almost forgive if we were, like, 19th, if we were in Palace's situation. Or something like that. Like, I don't know what point, you know, I'm not trying to be here like saying there is a point at which you're allowed to complain. There isn't a threshold. But at the same time, I was like, we've got to get this into perspective. We've got things pretty good on the pitch right now.
Yeah. Yeah, it's difficult. I don't want to ever tell people like what their threshold should be and how they should feel and da da da. I feel always, you know, ever since Marco's come in, I felt really chipper about pretty much everything we've done. And when there've been bad patches, I've thought, well, that's fine. It'll be a good patch soon. But yeah, it did feel unnecessary. And I think why it rankled so much with me was that it was really targeted towards him specifically. It wasn't about the team. It wasn't frustration at everyone.
Yeah. This one from, I think it's Gilles Stutgen. Gilles says, first of all, well done for the articles and podcasts. What you share with us makes our experience with Fulham FC much more enjoyable. Thank you very much. One thing that certainly does not make our life as a Fulham FC fan easy is the club's move to Ticketmaster. Even if this has absolutely nothing to do with you, I thought I'd share my email to the ticket supports team with you below, as I'm 100% sure I'm not the only one suffering for all those new issues amongst our great community of Fulham FC fans, and I'm worried it could have some negative impacts in the end. And he has shared this email with me, and actually, it would bloody annoy you. So effectively what happens is he bought 2 tickets for the Crystal Palace game for him and his son.
Mm-hmm.
His son is under 18.
Yeah.
And the Ticketmaster website just would not allow him to buy an under 18 ticket. So eventually, Gilles has just had to buy 2 adult tickets. And I mean, it's small. It's £12. But ultimately, if you're doing that every game and you're like, why am I like, it's purely just effectively, you can see what he's going through here. It's just like, it's saying, unfortunately, you're trying to purchase tickets for an age restricted price class. Please ensure the date of birth is assigned and stuff. I mean, it's just proper bang your head against a brick wall stuff. And I've used it. And whilst most times I've managed to get to the end result of what I'm trying to do, at no point do you go like, oh, that was a nice, easy user experience.
Yeah. The Fulham website, I try and steer clear. It's so difficult to use. And though point sometimes like where I've just been trying to buy like a simple thing and it will just push you through to an error page every time, and you're like, what's going on here? Like, how am I meant to deal with this?
Trying to like find something so basic as your loyalty points.
Oh, goodness.
And I know where to find it. It's not like I don't know, but each time I'm like, I click, I go on my profile on the Fulham website. No, it's not there. You've got to go click tickets. Then you've got to click profile. Then you've got to go to my account. Eventually you find it almost just by trial and error of clicking every button that's available to you. Mm-hmm. And eventually you find the one. My dad actually had a big problem on Saturday, that, and I know that lots of people with season ticket have had this problem where the ticket hadn't refreshed for the next game. So on his phone, it still had his Newcastle ticket
right
on in his wallet, and it didn't show Aston Villa. And so we're outside Craven Cottage at about 3 minutes to three. And I know that there's a problem. I know that there's an article on the Fulham website of telling you how to fix this. But of course, with the 5G, 4G, whatever G at Craven Cottage, if everyone, trying to get on the internet, I couldn't load the web page, which had the answer. Mm-hmm. And I was eventually managed to, and it must have taken about like 2 minutes just to load a simple web page of the Fulham, and it got there. So if you're wondering, if you're in this problem, there's a little thing that says automatic updates. And although my dad had it ticked, yes, you had to untick it and retick it again. And then all of a sudden, pop, out comes the Aston Villa ticket. It's just a bit rubbish, isn't it? Like, ultimately, we got there, we got in. And actually, I felt I knew that problem, and so therefore, but my dad would have, if it hadn't been for me being there, he'd have gone to the ticket office and he would have easily missed the first 20 minutes probably of the game whilst the ticket office did it for him. And you do just wonder how many people, you know, don't have a son that runs a Fulham podcast or that checks the website and knows that there's an issue. Because I wouldn't have known if I hadn't have seen some of the communication. And I know the club have tried to get that message out there, and but just build better systems in the first place. You don't need to have all these help articles and things.
Yeah, it's a real lack of investment into like a good system for buying these tickets, I feel. It's always so difficult. And you're right. Like, I'm generally fine because I'm able to figure it out. But for a lot of people that I know, like, that level of technological experience, it's not something that they've got. And like, why should they? Because they don't need it, or they don't, you know, they just want to go to the football. You shouldn't have to go through and like having to untick something and then retick it when it's already ticked in the first place is silly. Like, it just shouldn't be like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I do wonder if, like, you know, they brought it in and they obviously want, I can see the advantage to the club of everyone having a digital ticket. And I know that some people were able to kind of call the club and demand that they didn't, that they had a physical ticket for this season. But I wonder if it should have been a bit like, you know, kink out the problems with the people. I'd have actually voluntarily taken a digital ticket. Yeah. It makes my life way easier because I've been able to sell a couple of tickets. I sold one to you and it was, okay, the website's a bit cumbersome, but I got the job done.
Yeah. And like, if you're, you know, I mean, we work together and see each other every week, so you can hand over your ticket. But I've had experiences with people where we've been like sharing tickets and stuff, trying to find locations to meet up at some point during the week, or
posting.
Oh my god, yeah. I mean, let's not get into the postal system in this
country. It gets lost in the post. I've had that before where I've sent it first class to someone and I've regretted not sending it signed for or something like that because it got lost down the back of a postal van or something like that. I don't miss that personally, but I think for a lot of people, they're just like, I don't want all this faff. I liked having my card and I just wanted, I liked it how it was. And especially as there clearly are kinks in the system, I do wonder if they rushed into it a little bit. And yeah, that was particularly annoying.
Yeah.
Trying to deal with that.
It is interesting that they're still doing, and surprising that they're still doing, I think, the £2, well, used to be £1, now £2 pints for 2 p.m. Obviously that's, you know, in part at least to try and get people in well before the game so they don't have huge queues outside.
Felt like the queues on Saturday were bigger. I wonder if either the novelty of the whole pints at before 2 o'clock, maybe the weather as well, there's an element of like, you know, when it was the Leicester game and it was baking and sunshine, the whole get there early.
Well, it was a nice day on Saturday.
It was nice, but it's not, I wonder if, and this is possibly what they were worried about, and maybe even, sounds silly, but maybe even the fact it went from £1 to £2.
Rip off.
Made a few people go, oh, I might just go back to the pub for this one. I had my routine at the pub and I'm not going to worry about it. So, and the queues were big. The queues were long to get in, particularly for the Johnny Haynes stand. Hammersmith was all right.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, one thing that we, me and you actually had a little bit of an experience of the other day was the Riverside Walk.
Oh my God, it was nice.
That is quite cool.
Swish. Yeah.
If you're, not familiar with it, so they've now opened up on a non-match day the whole kind of like Riverside section underneath the Riverside stand. So if you were going for a walk or a jog along the river through Bishop's Park, you now don't have to go round the stadium, and you can act, you feel kind of like you're in the stadium, whilst also obviously they have sealed off like all the entrance points. Mm-hmm. And yeah, if you live or like go for runs around there, it must be like such a amazing thing. And obviously that was one of the big promises, is that they would open it up. And I was very impressed.
It was nice. It was really nice. We went on a really beautiful day as well, which definitely helped.
Yes.
Like sun was shining, light breeze in the air, river sparkling, river beautiful. But yeah, it's nice.
All right. Well, up next, we are going to play you what happened on Thursday at the Fulhamish live show, as we did This'll Catch On Live. Myself, George Cooper, Jack and Loz playing some of your best songs on stage. We'll take a quick break, and after that, we'll be back with that. So enjoy.
At Sierra, discover top workout gear at incredible prices, which might lead to another discovery. Your headphones haven't been connected this whole time. Awkward. Discover top brands at unexpectedly low prices. Sierra, let's get moving.
Whether you're ordering wings for the game, whipping up a seven-layer dip, or ordering pizza, there's something about football that makes you want to eat. And this football season, Uber Eats has the best deals on game day food. No matter what you're craving, from two-for-one pizza to buy one, get one wings, Uber Eats will be dropping new deals each week, all season long. Uber Eats, official on-demand delivery partner of the NFL. Order now. Terms and conditions apply. See app for details.
Welcome back to the Fulhamish podcast. I am live here at the Half Moon Putney. Yay! We have magically transported to Thursday. We're halfway through the week. Everton is in a couple of days. And right now, it is time for This'll Catch On. Yay! This is what you came for, isn't it? Now, everyone's here being polite while we chat about Andres Pereira and penalties and Tom Kenny. Everyone's like... In reality, everyone's just like, put the tunes on! There we go. So, joining me on stage, George Cooper. And still joining on stage, they came back 4 days later, Jack and Loz. Anyone not know what This'll Catch On is by this point? One person at the back. Right, so This'll Catch On is the part of the show where people send us little emails with MP3 attachments of songs that they dream of being sung by the Hammersmith End. They are never sung by the Hammersmith End. But we broadcast them anyway. And we have some corkers for you today. Now, for the first time, now I normally have listened to these chants beforehand. I've actually managed to do it today. So I haven't heard these either, which is kind of terrifying, to be perfectly honest. But producer Yasmin has been through them with a fine tooth comb and has selected five beauties, according to her. So any complaints, Yasmin's at the back. Are we ready? Jack and Loz, do you know what you got yourself in for?
We don't have to sing, do
that's
we?
That's what I was going to say. Like, yeah.
Oh, yes, sorry. Did I not make that part clear?
We're happy to sing along.
People will just leave if I start to sing. So I think it's better not to go down that route.
I think people might tip us, if to be honest. That is, right, let's go through. This first one is from Jordan Wilson-Pierce. Is Jordan here? Jordan isn't here. I know Jordan well. Jordan actually, fun fact, designed the Fulhamish logo.
Oh. Yeah. Talented man.
So he's a talented graphic designer, but is he a talented songwriter?
He's also done our book covers.
Oh, and he did the Jack and Loz book covers. Yes. So yes, very talented man, but we might be able to find a little bit more about Jordan right now. Jordan simply said, if 25,000 fans drunk on £1 lager, £2 today, can't remember those words, I give up. Is it crap? This is an entry for Anthony the Jedi Robinson, and it is to the Star Wars theme. Here we go.
This is my This'll Catch On submission for Anthony the Jedi Robinson. Da 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 da. Robinson. Robinson.
George?
I mean, he started that with, I've come up with it, and then proceeded just to hum the Star Wars theme. I think John Williams came up with that. I like it. Is it going to catch on?
Yes.
Should we give it a go?
Robinson.
It's not bad.
Well, he asked if 25,000 fans can sing it. 100 could. So, Jack and Loz?
Well, it's just been proven. It will catch on.
It will catch on. Yeah. There we go. Well done, Jordan. Talented graphic designer and talented kind of songwriter.
You know what? I could see that in a rowdy away day concourse at half time if we've got a jubilant first half performance. Everyone jumping up and down, they're just doing it for a long, long time. I could see that happening.
Can you see it on the 11:13 to Lime Street next weekend?
Manifest it, Sammy. Manifest.
Manifest it. The next one is from Jacob. Says, hi, Fulhamish team. I'm a long-time American Fulham fan. First time this'll catch on submitter, and we've thrown you in at the deep end. After his missed chances at the Etihad last weekend, I felt like Adama needed a little love. So I finally got the courage to record this song with my sister accompanying me on the ukulele. It is to the tune of the song Good Riddance by Green Day. I hope you enjoy, and maybe, just maybe, this will be played at the Fulhamish live show after the Villa game to celebrate a Fulham win and an Adama brace. He says, cheers from Jacob. So, let's hear it.
Stevenage Road, put him on the track, he'd win Olympic gold. Put baby oil on his arms and don't ask why. When he runs at your back line, you'll start to cry. Adama's unpredictable under the cottage light. We're so glad you play in black and white. You were coming off the bench in extra time. Now Marco Silva puts you in the starting line. With a tucked-in shirt, they're putting you on trial. For what it's worth, you make it look like it's in style. Adama's unpredictable under the cottage light. We're so glad you play black and white.
Oh, wow.
Adama's unpredictable under the cottage light. We're so glad you play black and white.
Wow. Jackie, your first words on Jacob's masterpiece.
So, Jacob and his sister are obviously very talented. I have one minor correction for which I apologise in advance. It would have been better to say about playing under the cottage lights and we're so glad you're with the black and whites.
Okay.
Sorry.
It's a half rhyme. It's a half rhyme. I feel like that's Jack's syllable police role that you're playing here today. In his absence. Loz?
I loved it. I thought it was absolutely brilliant.
And you're the Louis Walsh of this crew, aren't you?
Yeah.
I loved it.
It's brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. Loved it. And I'm not as pedantic as Jackie.
But George, you stood up halfway through the most premature standing ovation that's ever happened in the history of any song ever.
I also nearly fell over as well. I thought that was an absolute masterpiece. He'd be through to the judges' houses. Instant gold buzzer, the lot. I thought it was brilliant. Also, like, the combination of lyrics that are funny. Like, I love the rub baby oil on his arms, don't ask why. It's so good. And it worked. It's true to the song. To my knowledge, there's no mainstream chant to that Green Day tune. Yeah, good riddance. Mate, 5 stars. Amazing.
Fantastic. Well done, Jacob. You've stolen the show so far. Let's see if anyone else can do it. Next up, this is from James Drury. He says, "Hi, lads." He actually says, "All right, lads." Somehow, Vinicius is still with us. The next 4 words are amazing. Bonkers by Dizzy Rascal. Nothing more needs to be said. I will say no more. Oh my God.
I wake up every day, go to training. Fuck around, so funny, I'm amazing. I wake up, get fucked with my feet. Act real stupid because I can't compete. And all I care about is face up violence. A heavy head butt is my kind of silence. Marco says I gotta get a grip. Better let Sandy give me the slip. Some people think I'm bonkers. Paulina misses me. Man, I'm just living my life, yeah, I'm Carlos Vinny. Some people play for frills, rubber chickens for me. Man, I'm just living my life, yeah, I'm Carlos Vinny.
Such a long pause.
Wait for the drop.
Bonkers.
Oh, right. There's still quite a bit more to go.
I wake up every day, go to training. Fuck around, so funny, I'm amazing. I wake up, keep up with my feet. I act real stupid because I can't compete. And all I care about is face-up violence. A heavy head, but it's my kind of silence. Marco says I gotta get a grip. Better let Sandy give me the slip. Some people think it's bonkers. I'm still at FFC. And I'm just living my life, yeah, I'm Carlos Fanny. Some people pay for thrills. 2-1, fuck you, Chelsea. And I'm just living my life, yeah, I'm Carlos Fanny.
Oh, it's quite good. Oh, wow. that was... wow. Loz?
I like a bit of variety in my music, and I thought, well, what's the point of Vinicius? It's to basically score against Chelsea, so I'm hoping we're keeping in reserve for that. But I didn't witness anyone singing along, so I think it might need a bit of work.
Yeah,
but
I wouldn't say Bonkers by Dizzy Rascal is the simplest to sing along to, George. Can you see the Hammy End adopting that one?
I think I would probably say no on that one. Also, like, slight inaccuracy in the lyrics, I would argue. There was a lyric there saying, Paulina misses me. I think Carlos Vinicius is one of the main reasons that Paulina left, if we're being totally frank here, with the incessant pranks. He basically bullied him all the way to Bayern Munich. But yeah, it was good fun, though.
That and the paycheck.
Yeah.
Right, let's move on to the next one. This is from Doug Smith. Do we know if Doug's in the audience?
Catch on.
What a moment.
I don't think he's here, is he? No. So I think couldn't make it today, which is a real shame. Hello, Doug. Yeah, come on, Doug. Come on stage. Watch your feet, watch the wires. Please don't kill yourself. Wait, can we work out, what does this section of the audience love more, Tom Kenny or Doug? Doug, welcome to Fulhamish.
Thank you.
I haven't heard this, so we don't know.
I'm not gonna lie, it's a banger.
Okay. Right, I'll read you Doug's email, though he is here. Yeah, do you want to read your email, Doug? Yeah! From there, where my thumb is.
Lad, I think you will agree that this is an absolute banger. Full credit to the Kings of Leon for the instrumentation and the inspiration. Lyrics by me and my mate Hamish. Yeah. Produced by Dave Saunders. Vocals by me. All hail Adama. So say we all.
His muscles are oily. His shorts are so tight. The guard is just watching. We're watching. Run through defenders. Just in straight lines. They're quaking. They're quaking. Very exciting. Exciting. Then he got injured. Where did he go? Thought he'd gone missing. Gone missing.
Genius that made that. just what?
Doug,
what?
Have you got Pereira's
song? Doug, that was amazing. What inspired you? Well, Adama Traore.
All right. So first of all, his muscles are indeed oily, and his shorts are so tight. Look, my go-to karaoke song is "Sex on Fire" by the Kings of Leon.
Yeah.
When your top 10 show came out in August, I was like, I can do better than all of them.
Here we go.
And so my co-writer Hamish, who is also in the audience, we spent an entire day trading lyrics and trying to work this out. And then I got blackout drunk. Like a friend of a friend also turned out to be a music producer. And so I said, look, I'm gonna pay you a lot of money to put together this thing. And so they ripped the track off of we'll set aside the copyright.
Yeah, that's fine.
And that's how it came together.
You had me at the finish.
And rhyming triore with glory, you are a man after my own heart.
I'm not going to lie, rhyming triore with glory was literally the best thing I've ever done, including my three children.
Yeah.
And what are your plans for winter? Is it the Grammys? Is it the Brit Awards?
So today,
the Mercurys, I think.
When are they? Actually?
So the today, I've been working on an adaptation of Mr. Brightside for Mr. Bishop. Yeah!
If that doesn't get the folks in the audience to come back to the next live show, I don't know what will. Everyone, give it up for Doug. Thank you very much. Yeah, I'm really sorry for the person that is 5 out of 5 on this sheet.
It might be even better.
It could be. We can't say it's going to be even better.
No. Oh, sorry.
They bought half the tickets.
Sorry.
Right, this final one is from Sam Witcher, who actually has done a couple of great This Will Catch Ons in the past, and so I'm expecting this one to be a good one. Says, hi, Fulhamish. I can't see this catching on as a chance. I'm not the most confident start, but... But I couldn't think of a better song to reflect the mood that this man has brought to the fan base. There's a smile on everyone's face when he's talked about, as is when this song is heard, so I thought I'd try and put them together. Also featuring the man himself, Marco, and our very own Sammy James. I actually didn't read this, you can tell. Okay, I don't know what's coming up here. This is from Sam Witcher to the tune of Here Comes the Sun by the Beatles. It's a delightful number for Joachim Andersen. Yes. Okay.
Yes. Well, Joe, welcome back to London's oldest football club.
It's a little bit like coming home, so it's a good feeling.
Joe Anderson, doo-doo-doo-doo. Joe Anderson, and I say, he's alright. Oh, Yucky, we didn't see you play for Parker. Oh, Yucky, it's been 3 years since you've been here. Joe Anderson,
fantastic year here. I really love the club, so.
Oh, Yucky, the smiles return into our faces. Oh, Yucky, what did we miss that COVID year? Joe Anderson.
I can now get a lot more years to enjoy.
Yeah! And the
times 5.
As a player that is loving this football, I'm one of the ensure that is going to bring something really important for us, not just in terms of quality, leadership, maturity, and all that stuff, and it's going to be a very, very good tool in our season and further season as well.
And the sun, 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 sun.
That famous diagonal ball over the top. And I'm excited to see that back. Oh, nothing. Diagonal passes, hearts are melting. Oh, nothing. Silver for you. Joe Anderson.
Play in Europe, and I think that's also what we're going for. It's definitely a big dream for me and also the club. I think they are an ambitious club, so it's a perfect fit.
Thanks. That was very good. George?
Yeah, I'd love to. Beatles, can't go wrong. I quite like the sort of dreamlike sequences in between the verses. It was very apt of some of the Beatles' more hallucinationary music. That was good. I enjoyed it. I think the chorus could genuinely catch on as well.
Yeah, it's very, very nice. I really thought he was going to absolutely roast me for thinking that he was left-footed in the summer. I really thought that was the gag that was coming. I was like, oh, that's quite nice. You were quite generous to me. Right, we've got a... Loz, who was your favourite?
Dogs.
Jackie, is this clean sweep?
Yeah, triore glory.
George?
Yeah, I gotta go for Doug.
Doug stole the show. That'll do for This Will Catch On. Thank you very much to my guest, George Cooper. To Jack and to Loz. Thank you very much.
Welcome back to the Fulhamish podcast. Absolutely love hearing the live This Will Catch On renditions. If you were there on Saturday, hope you enjoyed. Salute once again to Doug.
Legend.
Absolute legend that is Doug for his amazing song. Liz, Everton, 5:30 on Saturday. It's on the box. Are you watching on the telly or are you heading up to Goodison?
I'm watching on the telly. It would be an overnight coach back home with a very character building 2 hours in Birmingham coach station at 1 a.m. So
yeah. And I think we've nearly sold out the allocation actually for Saturday, which is quite cool. I think a bigger allocation than normal as well, so I think a lot of people taking that opportunity to go up to Goodison for the final time. One of those stadiums that is amazing, but there's some stadiums worth saving.
If you're an Everton fan listening to this, I don't know why you would be, but Sammy's handle on Twitter, if you want to send him abuse, is at Mr. Sammy Jones.
Don't get me wrong. No, I like it. It's an amazing historic old ground. If you haven't been, you should go because it's, you know, one of those old fashioned grounds and we will be sad to lose it. But their new ground looks good. I don't think this is like we're losing Upton Park for the London Stadium. We are losing Goodison Park for what looks like quite a nice new ground. Mm-hmm. Like I feel like it's okay to let this one go. It is falling down and crumbling apart in places. It only had so much more of a shelf life.
Perhaps. I guess the proof will be in the pudding.
Yeah. I like the look of that new ground. I mean, it does also look a bit like a big Tesco's, which is quite funny.
I love big Tesco's.
So. Right up Liz's street.
Yeah, goodness. How exciting.
If you're going up on Saturday, enjoy it. If you're watching on the telly, enjoy it as well. Have a brilliant rest of your weekend. Liz, thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
And we will see you on Monday. Horny Whites.